Hello everyone and welcome back. My name is X Ferganator X, and today we're talking about another controversial subject today. Today we're going to be talking about something that is not actually exclusively to Halo, but it does affect Halo, and that is games as a service. For those that don't know what games as a service is, that's basically post-release monetization that is added content to the game after the games have been released that people can access online. Just like how there's pre-release stuff like pre-orders where you buy different editions and there's different content in it, whether it's a physical or digital way of getting that content, but basically that content that eventually gets added to the game. Due to unethical behaviors by a lot of companies, this is why it's become very controversial, because each type of business model has had much controversy around it, and people are always wondering what business model or form that Halo should go with and what works with the Halo community. And for those that don't know what the different types of games as a service are, there's four main ones. There's DLC expansions, there's season pass, battle passes, there's microtransaction, free-to-play loot boxes, and game subscriptions. Each of these I'll explain very briefly, try as best as possible, keep it short, to explain how these work and how what their pros and cons are, and how the community has, you know, reacted to this, which ones they prefer, and why is it so controversial amongst the gamers. First off, we have here is DLC, or downloadable content, and expansions. With the additional content that was added to the game post-release, these would be distributed from gaming systems like PlayStation Network, Xbox Live, Steam, and so forth. They could even be called macro transactions because they sold the content in bulks with DLC packs and expansions. They were, you know, simple aesthetic outfits like for your character's armor, new weapons, vehicles, new maps, new game modes, and even the expansions had new campaigns added all together. Best examples were like, Halo 3 Odyssey was supposed to be an expansion, but it ended up being its own game. But that was something that used to be talked about, how it was supposed to be an expansion. And then there was also the talk about Awakening the Nightmare DLC for Halo Wars 2 was an expansion. Those are some big examples of it. But other things that had, like map packs, like Halo 2 multiplayer map pack, which was at first a physical disc that you had to put in, but they ended up making an Xbox Live Marketplace where you could download it digitally, and then it ended up being something that lots of game companies took advantage of and started using that as a way to distribute content that people could buy. And this form of revenue has been the most common amongst the Halo games, and it was used for a very long time in the early 2000s. The reason why this content is not used anymore is because it was very abused, unfortunately. A lot of people go, oh, it was a perfect system, why can't Halo Infinite go back to that? And here's some of the problems with it. It felt like at first when you bought the game, these expansions and DLCs felt like actual additions to the games. But then slowly, it started feeling like you were getting less content for the game, and that they were just, these DLCs were just stuff that were already planned for the game that made the game feel full, and they just removed it and then sold it back to you as DLC. And it wasn't in, you know, everyone had that suspicion, but it wasn't until it was like really confirmed when hackers went into the game files and found that on games like Call of Duty 4, they had maps that were on the game disc, but then they made you pay for it. And then there was the whole controversy with Mass Effect 3. There was a bunch of controversies, but they found out that the character was actually in the game and that the map wasn't. And so basically it felt like what it is, they just removed the map and then just sold you back the map in order to play the storyline of the DLC character. But you already had the DLC character, which really was infuriating to a lot of people, saying that they were just taking content off the game and then reselling it back to you. And so this caused a lot of people just not to want to buy DLC. It was really starting to affect them negatively and wanting to purchase that. In fact, another game company, well, two companies that kind of like went crazy with DLC was Rock Band and Guitar Hero. They were pretty much almost to the point of microtransactions in the way that they were purchased, because they literally were selling $1 a song, and it was just like they were pumping these songs so much out. In order to buy all the songs, it would cost you thousands of dollars. And then another problem was, again, when people stopped buying the DLCs rely entirely on the gaming community to purchase the stuff. So when they stop buying it, or they don't buy as much, it negatively affects the business and it affects the gamers. When I played Medal of Honor 2010, there was a map that literally was no one could get out of the area, the spawn area, because the other guys were just spawn killing you, and it was just poor map design, and it was not tested out, nothing like that. So basically you got spawn killed right off the spot where you're supposed to try and take over a Chinook that had crashed, and you're supposed to capture it, but unfortunately you can't even make it out of the spawn points without getting killed. And also, because of the fact that people weren't purchasing all the DLC for the game, for these maps and whatnot, basically made it impossible for anyone to find matches sometimes with those low population counts. And the reason why this affected Halo in a negative way was the online features of it. Usually when a map pack came out with, everyone usually bought it, but whether it had been for like storage reasons, whether it had been for financial reasons, or whether you just did not want to buy that DLC, unfortunately, not many people saw this because people like me just bought all the DLC, so we never were affected by this. But if you didn't buy any DLC, you were basically banned from the matchmaking because every single playlist required it. And people would go, oh, well, why don't you just make separate playlists? But unfortunately, that would split the population, and that's a problem because if you split the population, it makes longer search times for games, and it didn't work for a lot of things. I mean, if you guys remember title update for Halo Reach, that split the community in 50, was it a 50-50 there, and basically made search times take way longer. It was not practical. So unfortunately, it just didn't work to make separate playlists. It makes it take longer to find playlists sometimes, and unfortunately, you get stuck with the same people over and over again. Bungie realized this was a bad design, and eventually they made all the content free. They made all the maps free, but basically it just did not work if you were just banned from the playlist, basically, for not buying DLC. And there was a great exploit that people used to abuse. I hated this so much, where they put all the DLC on an external hard drive and keep it plugged in their Xbox 360. And what they would do is, if a map came up, like say Sandbox came up, and they go, you guys, go ahead and veto this map. And is no one going to veto it? Is no one going to veto it? Okay, everyone listen up. You're either going to veto this map, or I'm going to pull the plug on my external hard drive and then force the map to change. So you can either veto right now, or I'm going to just pull the plug. And basically, that's what they did. They actually found a way of an exploit where they would plug a external hard drive with the maps, and if they didn't like the map, they just pull, and it was a DLC, they just pulled it, and it would force the map to change in a matchmaking thing. And I heard this so many times in matchmaking. It used to irritate me back when people didn't have party chats. People would say it's like really loud in the chat, and they would just be like, yeah, either it's gonna be my way or no way, you guys, which is kind of reminds me a little bit like a Halo MCC, where people go, either vote for Halo 3 maps or I'm quitting. Remember those, you guys? Remember when they put that on the nameplates? They would say, either vote for my map or I'm gonna quit, basically. They would say, lockout or quit. It was be something like that. It was like, oh my god, the passive aggressive behavior was really annoying. But yeah, that used to happen in Halo 3. So Halo Reach, they decided to change that. No more are we going to do this stuff. We're not going to force you guys to buy the DLC. If you buy it, you buy it. You don't buy it, you don't buy it. We're not going to make the playlist exclusive. When everyone's like, oh, yay, they finally did something about that. Yay. And actually, that was not a yay. That was actually horrible, because if you played big team battles and one person did not have that map, even though the other 15 people did pay for that map, you didn't get to play that map. And that was irritating, because you were reliant on that one person having that map, or else you could never play it. And that just became very annoying for a 16-player lobby, for one person not to have it, and then you can't play it. So this became very problematic for people wanting to just play the maps that they wanted to play, but they couldn't do it, because even though they paid for it, other people didn't buy it. So it just did not work, and that's why eventually it got phased out. So people were like, why can't we go back to these days? And it's because these days don't work anymore. If it was like, you know, the earlier years when everyone bought all the DLC from Halo, because Halo was all big back then, it works. But nowadays, if you want people to play but not be feeling forced to buy content, it doesn't work as a business model anymore for Halo, unless it is for single player stuff, like I said, with like ODST and for Awakening the Nightmare DLCs, that actually worked. But otherwise, if you're trying to force any multiplayer matchmaking features, that's when there's a problem. This is when we also ended up later on seeing season passes and battle passes, which were basically similar to DLCs, except that instead you paid for the DLC in advance, and basically when it came out, you got to have it. It was basically usually either every season or a whole year, you got all sorts of new content. There was also battle passes, which were basically season passes with in-game progression in it, but you got all these new cosmetics. And also the great part about it was, is if you didn't pay for this stuff, you still got free updates and you still got new maps and new game modes. But if you wanted the cosmetics, you had to pay for those season passes. So it kind of worked out in a way. But yeah, some people like the battle passes because it keeps you engaged longer, but other people don't like it because they don't have time to go through all that progression. So that's why there's just some negatives there, why some people don't like it. Also, the fact is you are completely reliant on the game company staying around. So if you're someone that doesn't, the game company doesn't stay around, doesn't stick around, you end up spending all that money and losing everything. Just imagine if Mass Effect Andromeda had been a season pass. If it had been a season pass and they just abandoned the game, which they did, you just paid for all that DLC and good luck getting a refund, because if like that company goes out of business, you can't get a refund. So you're done. Most times they don't even give you a refund anyway, but if you paid for all that DLC in advance and you didn't get anything out of it, that sucks. So that's another reason why just season passes have had such a negative. So that insecurity of, you know, you pay for something and then it ends up not falling through, because anyone can just make a roadmap and tell you, oh, okay, this is what the season pass is going to have, and they can just write that down there and then never follow through with it, as some companies have, where they put a roadmap out and then end up constantly delaying. It's caused people to get really annoyed by that. And just like DLCs, these things can flop. If they end up flopping, it's a waste of time for a company to make a DLC or a season pass, and the content just flops. No one ends up buying it. So that can also be a huge factor of why companies don't like to engage in this, because it's not always reliant. Then you got things like game subscriptions, which are where you pay a monthly fee. You end up don't pay usually any other form of payment. Sometimes they are in-game progression. Sometimes for very few other games, there also is in-game purchases as well still. But for the most part, you just pay for a fee to get into the game, and that's all you pay for. You just pay a monthly fee, and all the content is usually free. That's usually the only form of payment. There's sometimes, again, rare occasions where that's a little bit different. This is very common on PC games. I think EVE Online does this. But this could also be like if you just pay regular gold Xbox Live accounts and you get, you know, free games, free with gold games. That's also another example. Basically, you're paying monthly for Xbox Live and then you get some free games with gold and then you get to play that way. But it might not work really with Halo, because the idea you pay a $60 game plus paying $60 for Xbox Live, and then paying $3 for $3 a subscription fee on top of that just does not really seem to work out very well for it as a business model. But if it is going to be Halo Infinite, which I don't think so, because obviously it's going to be a franchise, not a trilogy, so they're going to keep making more Halo games. But if they were to say that Halo is going to be their last Halo game and they were just going to continue just adding content, just that one game, subscription fees could actually work for it. But unfortunately, it just does not work in that manner if you're going to continue to make other games. Because not just Halo, but any game that wants to do sequels, if you make a subscription service, now you got to back both of them up with new content all the time. And unfortunately, that's not really going to work. So it's hard to keep people to move on to the next one and say, oh, we're going to have to shut down the service to force people to jump onto the next one. And that's just not going to make anyone happy with that kind of business model strategy of trying to force people to go that route. And there's other drawbacks too with subscription fees. A lot of people go, oh, it doesn't sound that bad. But if you guys remember, if any of you ever played The Old Republic, which was by BioWare, Star Wars The Old Republic, which used to be called Tortanic, magically the button just goes missing all of a sudden, no matter which internet browser you use, the unsubscribe, you couldn't find it anywhere. And gamers are calling their credit card companies trying to stop the payments to them. And basically we're banning people on the forums for providing the URL link to get directly to the unsubscribe button, all due to a situation that happened where there was a bunch of bugs and balancing issues that were happening, and BioWare wasn't quick enough to address them, and people were trying to unsubscribe. And again, BioWare, somehow their unsubscribe button just magically goes missing. They say it was a technical issue, but other people felt like they were just stealing from them and that there was no way to unsubscribe. And eventually they did end up getting this fix, and I think Tortanic ended up going free eventually. But it still left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths when it came to how they decided to do this business model that seemed to magically just, as all these issues happen, the unsubscribe button goes missing. It just really set off a lot of people. And also the fact is if you can't keep paying for this online feature, you lose ability to the online aspects of that game usually. And so basically, even though you pay for a $60 game sometimes it's free, but sometimes you paid $60, you're SOL if you can't pay. This is why, even though they're trying to, you know, Google Stadia is trying to push this all, hey, we're going to do streaming services, this is the way of the future, whatnot.
Mutants are the future. Look at this one. He's got web toes. Shouldn't he be president?
A lot of gamers don't like this because the fact is, when you they try to say it's like Xbox Live and whatnot, but the thing is, when I have an Xbox and I have a game, I paid for it, and even if I have no internet connection, because say for example, if my internet goes down, or whether Xbox Live goes down, or somehow I get banned, I'm not going to go through the whole story about that, but basically people getting wrongfully banned, and now they can't get online and get a hold of their games now. At least when I have a physical box with a physical copy, I can still play the game. Or at least the game downloaded to my Xbox. But for those that have to rely on a streaming service where they have no access to that server, that's a problem. And say, for example, let's pretend like it's like Netflix, where basically the game decides to, the company that has their game on that streaming service decides, no, we're not going to put that on there anymore. Just like think of Netflix when Disney pulled out of it. Think of it like that. Even though Google Stadia tries to say they're not like that, but it has similar design. And so say, for example, Halo were to put on Google Stadia, but then Google Stadia, or 343 says, now we want to pull our game off of that. Well, now you just paid $60 for a game with all the content that you also have to pay for while paying for the streaming service, and you just paid all that. Now you can't have access to that game anymore. So unless you're going to build a business model for Google Stadia where you can, any game that you buy, you have some sort of like hard drive thing that you can still play it, even when the service goes down, you can still play offline features. Unless they have that, there's no reason to use Google Stadia. I can go for a long ass rant, but there's so many other YouTubers that talked about that, so I'm not going to go through all that. But basically, it just does not work. Streaming services and subscription fees and stuff like that are not very reliant because of the fact that you're completely at their mercy. And if they decide to not provide any new content, but you're paying for that service, you're wasting money. And if there's a bug, sometimes not just BioWare Titanic, but other companies have been claimed to have done stuff like this around the billing cycle. When the next billing cycle happens, they just magically, the unsubscribe just magically goes missing. And next up, we have the last but not the least, microtransactions. These are the exact opposite of DLCs, where DLCs were macro. Micro is like, you know, individual items that you can buy. Instead of like having to buy in bulks, now you can buy the individual items that you want. So say, for example, all those armors, you only want two or three of them. You don't want to pay for the rest of this and get it cheaper. You can do that. And so it gave more options for people that could buy what they want when they wanted to and not feel forced. And all the DLC, all the maps and stuff, all the added maps were usually free updates, free game mode updates, free content updates. The only thing you paid for was the armors and stuff like that, which was kind of like, at first, you know, a lot of companies, it was like, oh, that's great, yay, and whatnot. And, but then, you know, it also basically made a lot of companies a lot of money, so they usually made all that other content free, and also that you could even go the route of not paying for anything and just use in-game currency. But unfortunately, what would end up happening is it would end up making the game more grindier in order to compensate, to try and influence people to buy microtransactions. And then what they did to try and influence people to buy microtransactions more was instead say, hey, instead of buying directly that, you can pay for loot box. And if you go through the loot box system, it's going to be cheaper and you have a higher chance of getting it. But then also, if you don't have good luck, you might end up spending more instead of what you would actually want and not be able to directly buy what you wanted. And then you could go as far as what ended up Star Wars Battlefront 2 with EA did, and they ended up really pissing off a lot of people because basically they made it, the loot box system, how it was designed was if you did in-game, it was grindy as hell, it took forever to unlock, but even if you tried to purchase loot boxes and tried to go that route, overall in the end, the amount of time it took to progress through the game, no matter which route you took, you're going to spend at least $1,000, whether you spend $1,000 directly buying loot boxes or $1,000 on your electricity bill, bill and your phone, not electricity bill, your internet bill, everything like that. Someone did like crunched all the numbers, and on average, you're going to spend just as much. You're going to spend equally almost $1,000 no matter which way you go. So it was very frustrating to hear about that and that whole business model. And people got frustrated about this like design of it. And this is what ended up getting the spotlights of companies making governments now consider wanting to ban loot boxes because of the fact that this was even in like games for kids where it was predatory, where it was intentionally taking advantage of it. And people go, oh yeah, you know, it's not that bad, it's all RNG. But actually, something else I also want to talk about, a little story here that was very what the fuck, was I was in this group of indie devs where people talk about how they're helping make games and talk about games and helping one another with developing their own games. So people like to help each other and whatnot. Well, this guy decides to come into the conversation and he asks help with RNG loot boxes. And he wasn't asking about how to make RNG loot boxes. He was asking how to falsify the numbers. So he was asking people to, he goes, hey, can anyone help me? What I want to do is I want to make it so if anyone tries to access the game files and looks at the numbers, they see one set of numbers, but instead there's a whole different set of numbers. So if they see these loot boxes are like a 20% chance they'll get this item, if they run this loot box, that that's what they'll see. But in reality, it'll only be like 3%. He didn't say the exact numbers, but the way he worded it, everyone knew what he was saying. And so it was like the few times where the devs stood up for gamers and people in there said, dude, fuck off with that. If you're to do that kind of shit, you should actually get arrested. And this guy really was full on promoting, trying to steal from people by promoting this kind of thing, and people just told him to get fucking lost, dude. It was like people were really annoyed by that. Like, people already giving a shit for loot boxes and games, and you know what, you're gonna do that, just get out of this group and whatnot. And so people were pretty mad at this dude trying to basically ask for help to basically deceive people. And he goes, well, if other companies do it, it's not a big deal, it's not illegal yet, whatnot. You tried to justify this stuff. And basically, that's another thing of why I hate loot boxes, the fact that you have no idea what numbers you're giving. And this guy might not, he might just be an indie guy. What's the chances these big companies are also doing the same exact behaviors? There's no one to actually hold them accountable. And unfortunately, China tried to do something like that. They tried to pass a law saying you have to give the numbers out. And I'm not going to go through the whole story here, but go look up what Blizzard did with Overwatch, how they decided they're not going to comply with that, and instead they're going to find another workaround. And so, yeah, it's really annoying that they do stuff like this, where they'll do anything to hide their numbers. And it kind of makes me suspicious when they're too afraid to give out their numbers of their probability chances. It makes it sound like they aren't truly being honest about their games, if they're willing to hide those kind of numbers. So, the whole idea that this is something that's almost, gambling designed, and yet children have access to this, is why it's becoming something that is getting attention from governments about, apparently they're going to get involved on this. It's like, in a way, I don't like government getting involved, but unfortunately, these companies are abusing it to the point where it's actually becoming so predatory that it's going to cause this to happen. Even if you don't want it to, it's definitely going to happen. If these companies keep continuing down this route, they're going to have to start, finding new forms of business models. And this is why also things become, with the free-to-play games, they get called pay-to-win, because you pretty much pay for advantage. You get advantage over other players, sometimes even actual like content that helps you in the game. So even this one game I played, Total Domination, I can't remember the exact name of it. It's a free-to-play game on Facebook. But yeah, people pay to win on there all the time, and I just like, dude, this is unfair. There should be like some strategy in this game. It's supposed to be called a strategy game, but yet people just pay and just mass raid people with large numbers of fleets that you can't fight back with. And so I said, I wish they would have like a way to balance this for people that aren't, pay to win. They just want to play the game. And people will immediately tag you saying, no, if I pay money for this game, I should have an advantage over other players. And so they become a little bit entitled, thinking that because they pay for it, they should have a better chance of winning over other people, which takes away the fun out of it. And then you have them complain about, why is no one playing our games anymore? Or like, not the game companies themselves, but people playing, get annoyed now because now all the people that pay to win are the ones playing it. And then they complain about the population count just dropping, where only all the top players are playing and everyone else has left the game and the population has died to next to nothing. And they sit there and go, we don't understand why there's people not playing our games anymore. What's going on? But yeah, with Halo, that's why loot boxes aren't welcomed in Halo 5, unfortunately, because of the fact that it's just basically people paying the win. I don't want to pick on this guy too many times because I've already mentioned him a few times in my video, and I'm not trying to, beat him down more. He's already probably feels embarrassed about the whole situation. So, but it is for reference here. Not just him, but a couple other people that all just, they thought that they were going to get, if they get to level 152 in Halo 5, that they're going to get some sort of unlocks, free exclusive unlocks in Halo Infinite, that they're going to get some exclusive armor. And so he paid a bunch of money for a bunch of gold packs so he could boost up to get to 152 quicker than people like me who just regularly play. And then they say, oh, it's not fair. I should get exclusive armor and whatnot. And he didn't say this specifically. He got just disappointed by hearing the news that he just spent a bunch of money and he's not going to get exclusive armor. But you have other people sitting there, well we paid for this, and also you have the time, 343, so you should make an exclusive armor for us. And they sound really entitled. It's like, wow, imagine actually paying real money in a game to get exclusive content. That sounds pretty selfish. But yeah, it's something that's just, unfortunately, it grows a little bit of sense of entitlement. The problem is, though, it works really well for financially for companies, but it also works great for people that are adults to play games that don't have all this time to play it. So, you know, they don't have that 8 hours a day playing video games versus like some people that have like hours on end to play. Some people just have maybe 1 or 2 hours a day, maybe 1 or 2 hours a week to ever play any video games, even if they don't even play at all. So it's very frustrating to go down that route and just not be able to play games because you just don't have the time. So it's nice to be able to catch up to the people and just pay a few extra bucks and be able to, you know, get some of those armors that everyone else, you know, worked for and just be done with it. And that's like a way to catch up, because it kind of sucks that it's not like the old days where everyone had the same content, the same access, and same ability to get that content. So now it's become more of a grind fest. So that's some of the negatives there. So when it comes down to it, you ask yourself, what's the best route to go with here? Because unfortunately, there's so many different things that we that are negatives for each of these business models. And also, again, that's why games as a service gets a dirty word, because a lot of companies have pulled a lot of BS with their games. A lot of negative things have happened. So it's just like, but unfortunately, that's the only way that these companies can actually keep developers in developing their games while at the same time still generating a profit while still providing gamers new content online. Otherwise, you just would get the game and there would be no new content to be added into the game, and that's it for the rest of the time. And unfortunately, that won't maintain a population usually if there's nothing new to come back to. Sometimes people like the in-game progression, though, and some people don't. They just want to have the new content. So what's the best route here? I have two things that when I was talking to people, doing a poll on this, seeing where everyone stood on this, and so I came down to two possibilities of what we can go here with that work for Halo, at least. If you're going to have a game that's going to be a continuation of the franchise, it's not going to be the final game that's going to keep going on, because if that were the case, then game subscription might actually be the best route of all of them. But when it comes down to it, you know that 343 is not going to be going out of business anytime soon. So that's some things you can take into account. A factor here of what you can add in. And looking at what people said, they really like season passes and battle passes. I personally, if I'm going to go with either one of them, I'd rather go with a season pass than a battle pass, because I don't have the time to go through that kind of progression. But I would rather go for that than a battle pass. But either one of those, that's something people like. That's option one. That pretty much covers everything. The other possibility is to do microtransactions. I know everyone, you know, don't freak out, but microtransactions that keep true to only cosmetics. No loot boxes, just cosmetic stuff. And you can just buy the cosmetics. Either way, that or the season passes at least makes all the content maps free for everyone, but all that other DLC stuff like armors and skins and stuff like that would actually be stuff that people that paid the season pass would get, or the microtransactions, or in-game currency if you can unlock it that way. Those two are the best possible routes to go with for everything, but everything else wise, I don't see that working. The only way I see DLCs and expansions working is only for anything that's like solo play, for like campaign mainly, stuff like how Halo 3 ODST was in the Awakening Nightmare DLC. If they go one of those two routes, they either go season passes or microtransactions that are cosmetic only, direct purchases, no loot boxes, with DLCs being expansions for the single player, I see that as the best route for Halo, where it won't actually be something that'll negatively affect gamers, because unfortunately DLC and matchmaking is just not going to work, and subscription fees are just not going to work either. But a lot of people are already celebrating way too early about the whole no loot boxes. When you look at what he said, he worded it specially in a way that a lot of us that are very careful at keeping attention to detail are very skeptical about Halo Infinite when they say no real money loot boxes. And I'm sorry, but if you know how to read between the lines, that's kind of concerning, because they didn't just say flat out like no loot boxes. They said no loot boxes in Halo Infinite, we'd be done with this conversation about no loot boxes. But they said no real money loot boxes, and I kind of did a joke about that, saying that they can just quite simply just add an in-game currency and you spend money to buy in-game currency where you end up using a loot box. And if that's the case, that all they did is just add an extra step. They didn't actually solve the problem. They just said instead of paying directly for the loot box, you're paying for an in-game currency with credits or something like that, and then you buy a loot box. So I'd rather if they do any of those two, it's either season pass or they do microtransaction direct purchases, but they only make it for a certain amount of them. And any of the really good armors, they don't make them something that you can directly purchase. That it has to be entirely unlocked. But anyways, that's where I stand on this. And you guys comment down below what you guys think, if it actually is something that what your guys' idea of what games as a service should be, whether they should have subscriptions, whether season passes, DLC, microtransactions. What are you guys' opinions on this? What should the route that Halo should go with? You know, comment down below what your opinions are and why that is, and what your, you know, I would actually be interested in what your rebuttals are against the negatives, like saying, oh, well, I want to go back to DLC, and then you go, what about the fact that it excludes out certain people? What is your argument against that? But I'd be very interested in that. Also, if you guys want to get more videos on this, go subscribe. Rate the video if you want to like it, dislike it, and also hit those notifications if you want to get notified when new videos drop. Anyways, I'm gonna let you guys go. You all take care, and you have the great rest of your day. Peace. One.